A quarter of adults in Britain are so obsessed with cleaning and tidying that they spend 2.5 hours or more every weekday on household chores, with many feeling compelled to abide by strict regimes and rituals.
I have to clean the door handles probably anything up to 200 times a day.
I've got a thing about even numbers, so volumes on TV will always be on even numbers.
This is the ensuite bathroom. Don't use the bath. Refer to it as our big ornament.
But for most of us, keeping our homes clean and tidy is not a priority. With 73% of people admitting they hide things behind sofas when expecting a visitor.
There is poo.
There is actually poo.
Not good.
And a messy 57% of Brits often describing their home as a pigsty.
Yeah, my living room's a bit of a mess. We can't find the whole floor.
So can a group of obsessive cleaners transform the habits of a nation?
Moths have already taken to it.
Just makes me feel a bit...
I think I'll knock with me feet.
Or will changing the lives of those with a very different attitude to cleanliness prove too much for the people whose need for perfection...
Do you mind if I just step out? Just the sheer smell...
has become an obsession.
Whoa, whoa, woo!
You're just walking off like some sort of...
Clive needs to put his hand down his pants, find his balls and make a decision.
You'd just be amazed. The amount of disgusting muck that accumulates here.
30-year-old payroll administrator Glenn from Watford spends 16 hours a week keeping his one-bedroom apartment immaculate.
Cleaning is very important to me. This is a rental property, so to make it ours, really had to go through and just scrub everything until my fingers bled. I sometimes think it's not so much the cleaning itself, it's the buzz I get from it. I think it's a control thing, really, because out there, I haven't really got control over anything, but in here, I'm the boss. I do like the shower curtains hanging a particular way, and the towel, like that.
Glenn's favourite objects are a spirit level and a tape measure that he uses to line up almost everything he owns.
The idea for this just kind of came to me, really. I want it perfect. The right way.
Glenn only ever prepares ready meals that require one plate, one oven tray, and one knife and fork.
So even if the hob hasn't been used, it still gets a clean. I don't cook, ever. It's just the creation of mess and crumbs and washing up. I would rather have an immaculate kitchen than something to eat. Some of my traits are obsessive compulsive, but they are irrational, like opening the cupboards and touching things. Just to touch them, like that, and it's all fine. Touching things that haven't moved, I know it doesn't make sense, but I'm not bothering anybody.
Glenn wants to use his passion for cleaning to change the life of someone whose domestic habits are very different from his own.
I would really like the opportunity to be able to help someone who's let things get on top of them and really, you know, really wants to turn over a new leaf, and I think I've got it in my power to help.
Glenn's taking his obsessive cleaning habit from his one-bedroom flat in Bedfordshire, 100 miles away, to Shanklin on the Isle of Wight.
Oh, I see. The curtains could do with a wash, I reckon.
Glenn will be spending the next 4 days in this 15-roomed ex-hotel.
This is an African witch doctor's mask, and it was given to me by a shaman as I performed some magic for them. So this is a Tibetan exorcist's pouch, and this came from Lhasa. This is a missile plotting chart from the good old days of the Cold War.
48-year-old David moved his vast collection into this house 15 years ago, and has since managed to fill each of the 15 rooms and every other available surface.
I'm a collector, and collecting is far different to hoarding. I collected since I was about 4 years old, and I'm interested in most things. Anything historical that comes my way, I like to be able to touch history, not just read about it.
David claims a varied CV ranging from private investigator to archaeologist to magician. His home is a reflection of his many interests, including 300,000 books, 10 African masks, 25 military uniforms, and a range of magician's props.
This is an interesting magic item. It defies gravity. I think the collecting side of it stems from the fact that when I was 4 years old, or thereabouts, my mother gave away some of my toys and I was so upset that my father ended up going back to the fete and buying them all back again. But I think I've collected things ever since.
I'm a collector, not a hoarder.
It doesn't represent him very well, whereas he's a really nice bloke, you know? Really good fun and great sense of humour.
But with increasingly poor health, David has asked for help in bringing some order to the chaos and to turn this ex-hotel back into a home.
The house was last cleaned, I think, probably properly about 10 years ago. As my health deteriorates over the years, I'm finding it harder and harder to cope.
I think it's totally not good for health. I think he needs to clear everything and start afresh.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm David.
Glenn.
Welcome to my house.
Thank you. Wow. This is incredible.
So here's the kitchen.
Already there's more items and objects than I've got in my entire home. So is the whole house like this?
Oh no, the whole house is a lot worse.
Wow. I certainly wouldn't let anybody see, you know, my kitchen if it was like this.
You're scratching yourself again.
Yes, I'm just stunned. Yeah, do you know what? I'm just going to put my gloves on.
Let's go and have a look at the hotel bar.
Oh, it's quite tight, isn't it? It's quite difficult to even, like, get across the room, isn't it? You might notice I'm rubbing my hands together, I'm scratching my neck. It's just when I'm a bit unsure and a bit overwhelmed as I am.
I can understand
this
that.
This is what I do. What is this?
Well, that's Maybe a Fiji mermaid. The front end of this is basically a capuchin monkey and the rest of it is sort of a carp.
This is a fascinating piece and it's on a pile of stuff in this room behind a closed door. So we've got aviator goggles.
Yes, I used to fly. I've raced boats, I've raced airplanes, and I've raced cars.
Right.
This used to be the hotel dining room.
This is just nothing like my house at all. Oh, fresh air. Dear me. At the moment, I'm feeling like I've really got my work cut out for me. I was stunned that someone could just bumble around and quite happily ignore the rooms in that state. It was just disgusting. It was rancid.
I can understand his point of view. I just hope that he can understand mine. This is real life and not a surgical ward.
Glenn is only too aware of the scale of the task ahead, so gives David a taste of what lies in store.
Right, so I brought with me some pictures of my home.
Yes.
Now I've seen how you live, I thought you might be interested to see how I live.
So and here this we is are. The hall.
Hoovered daily, skirting boards dusted. Pictures dusted, adjusted with spirit levels. The kitchen, everything buffed, shined. The tops of the kitchen cabinets are done once a week. We've got the living room. That's dusted, hoovered, everything, skirting boards, light bulbs.
Not a lot of stuff.
It's still obviously a home, not like a hotel room or something, but it's clean.
Hey, see, I was just thinking that. Hotel room.
Hotel room, really?
Yeah.
That's what I've tried to avoid. I don't think he's quite grasping what we're going to do. I'm a doer. I want to get involved and get it sorted.
I think my house represents me in that it's slightly eccentric, slightly weird, and shows an awful lot of things that I've done in my life.
In the UK, 30% of us admit to never cleaning our windows. Yet there is a group of Brits who are waging a war on dirt and clutter. 42-year-old full-time area bank manager and single mother Zara spends 4 hours a day making sure her house achieves impeccable show home standards.
I've got a white sofa that you don't really sit on, so I suppose you could say that's a show sofa. I've got cushions you don't lean on, so they're like show cushions.
I'll puff this probably about 30 times a day.
I don't think if there was a natural disaster, I think I'd still have time to, like, fluff a cushion.
Striving for perfection is not just limited to the living room.
A show towel is like a display towel. It's a towel in your bathroom, but it's not to be used. It's just to be like two squares folded over. And when I've got my stripe quilt, it has to be on a certain stripe of the quilt. This blind always has to go in this position so that this bit is level with that.
Zara also vacuums four times a day, ensuring every inch of her home is pristine.
I love my Hoover.
And 8-year-old daughter Izzy is being trained up to mum's standards.
You are not allowed to lean on the cushions. 6, you are not allowed to use show towels.
I really don't care what other people think. I was brought up on pledge, so yeah, and I'm fine. So, you know, it's not going to kill her.
Definitely. I'm definitely not turning into you.
You will, because I said that about Nanny.
I don't want to be a lunatic. You're like a robot that just, like, has a system that needs to clean.
Zara has decided to take 4 days out of her busy life in the hope that someone else will benefit from her extraordinary cleaning talents.
I don't understand. I could live in squalor. I want to live in squalor. So I'm going to show people my way, the way of the show towels.
She's travelling 200 miles from Chelsfield, Kent, to South Wales to clean a home that doesn't quite come up to her show home standards.
Keep going past these houses thinking, I wonder if it's a house like that.
...37-year-old shop owner Jo from Bridgend lives with her two sons and husband Clive. Her home is consumed by over 7 years' worth of clutter.
This is our living room. As you can see, there's not much room here. This is all cluttered with toys, clothes, and a shopaholic. If I hadn't been out and bought anything, I used to get quite depressed.
Jo's compulsive shopping habits and inability to throw anything away means her son Dan's bedroom is almost inaccessible due to piles of clothes, toys and board games.
I would like more room in our house to play. When I have my friend around, we usually play like a nice little board game, like Monopoly or something. We usually have a board up here and play up here on the bed.
Jo has formed a sentimental attachment to the whole family's belongings and after 7 years has finally acknowledged she's unable to sort the mess on her own.
I just want to try and get the house sorted that I can come home from work, see the boys and then we can do jigsaws together like we always did.
Zara has just 4 days to declutter Jo's 2 tons of clothes and children's items.
Nice to meet you. Watch your breaking neck.
Oh, I might break my neck.
Right, if you want to follow me up here now.
I'll just put my bag there, Jo.
Yeah, I must warn you, mind, it is total wipeout. These are the wardrobes I can't exactly get to.
Oh, God, so, Jo, this is a...
You
can't even get the door open, can you?
Yeah, so...
I couldn't sleep in here. Like, my hands are really sweaty and it... And I just want to sort it out. I just want to fling open the windows and I just want to pull everything out and sort it out with you. And I feel quite sad that this is your room.
This is my Danny boy's room, Mrs. Well...
Oh, my God, Jo.
It will be when it's...
If anything, this is worse than your room, I think. Do you not think you need to set an example?
It does make me feel bad and that is why I want to get it done. I'll take you into the living room now.
It's a little bit cluttered, isn't it? See, I could not have a monkey on the back of my sofa. I've got a brown leather sofa like you, but I've got a cream sofa opposite and no-one sits on it. Nothing goes on it.
What happens if somebody comes in and they go to sit down then?
I couldn't concentrate on anything other than you're sitting somewhere you shouldn't sit. Where do our kids play? There's not one available inch of room. Something's got to give.
Having seen the extent of the clutter, Zara's keen to share her plan for the next 4 days with Jo.
We need to sort out what we're doing going forward. Project, clean the house, tidy the house. It's
to get a show house. We'll clean it thoroughly and then we'll just try and find a place for everything. We can crack on with full clean in the morning. How are you feeling about that?
Ready to go.
On the Isle of Wight, Glenn has 4 days to tackle the former 15-roomed hotel. He's decided he will only be able to manage 3 of the rooms, the old bar, adjoining dining room, and the kitchen.
Walking in afresh, I mean, the smell is really strong. If anything, it's worse than yesterday.
Before Glenn can address David's historical hoard, first he wants to attack the 15 years of grime.
I would like to tackle the kitchen, clear all these surfaces so we can see what we're dealing with. I'm putting you on bin bag duty. That one.
What's in that one?
You don't need a selection of chocolate drinks. Surely one's enough.
Yes, I do.
You want to keep that? That's quite a dirty jar.
No, go on.
A new bag of sugar. Yep, good. I mean, I'm going to assume anything in the lower levels is going to be rubbish.
As an archaeologist, I can say the lower levels are always the most valuable.
Bread sauce, July 2008, David.
It's in a packet.
David, you're telling me that you think, oh, I fancy a bit of bread sauce, you're going to crack this open and serve it this evening?
Yeah, I would do.
Or would you leave it here to rot? No. It's going in the rubbish.
4 hours and 10 bin bags of rubbish later, the kitchen surfaces are finally clear. And Glenn can move on to the antiquated fridge.
Careful of the water.
OK, let's see what's going to happen when we open the door. Wow. Sticky, they are not wrong. Toffee pudding.
David bought this vintage fridge 15 years ago and has never once cleaned or defrosted it.
Go.
Oh. OK, it can go.
Oh.
Or do I want to keep it? You all right?
Yes, I'm all right, I'm all right.
Purple and there.
It's just rot and it's dirt and it's mould and it's just... Oh, it's disgusting and it's making me like... What baffles me also is your complete lack of shame about it. Like, how are you feeling with my reaction to your fridge?
I can understand your reaction to my fridge, yeah.
I mean, can you get the smell as well?
Yeah.
You can. I mean, would you want to put your head down and have a good sniff down there? I don't think you would you? It's not pleasant,
is it? It's not exactly pleasant, no.
No, I think, to be honest, it's going to have to go.
It's a collectible 1950s.
Yeah, but it's, I mean, it's ruined, it's dirty. Look at this down here. This is disgusting. This is completely unsalvageable.
With the fridge too large to move, it must stay. So Glenn has hired some removal men to skip David's chest freezer to make way for a new additional fridge instead. It's been left unplugged and hasn't been opened for 15 years.
Oh dear.
Let me get out of it.
There's not a bit of shame or anything. It's muck on me. I don't know what it is.
One in 50 people in Britain are diagnosed with obsessive compulsive disorder. For some, this can manifest itself in ritualistic behaviour and a fear of germs.
If there's a circle, I've got to start all over again with the bleach.
Although we come into contact with millions of harmless bacteria every day, for germophobes with a fear of contamination, all bacteria are terrifying.
We're standing in it. Poo.
Mum of three, Hayley, was diagnosed with OCD in 2007, and her obsessional behaviour has impacted on many areas of her life.
Throughout my life, I've had different forms of the OCD. But sometimes I might get intrusive thoughts. I fear that if I don't carry out these rituals, that my children will die. So for me, the important thing to confront my fears.
Literally, a part of me has just died inside.
The more I do that, it makes me have control over the illness as opposed to it having control over me.
Tonight, fellow OCD diagnosed Leslie and Tuesday and order-obsessed Mark are joining Hayley. They're taking themselves out of their comfort zone by doing something they rarely do, bowling.
How are you with door handles?
Yeah, I don't have a problem with door handles.
Well, none of us can touch the door handle.
No. Good job, Ria.
Don't worry, I've got the door.
The newly OCD-diagnosed Leslie, it's a big night, as she's not been to a place of entertainment for over 20 years.
Nights out? No, 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 no. All the crowds of people, the dirty glasses, the smells. Too much. I could be home polishing.
Do you want to take your shoes off, guys, and we do a swap?
No, 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 no.
You can't do that. You're not wearing them?
No.
You need to wear the shoes, I'm afraid.
In the UK, it's not a legal requirement to sanitise bowling shoes after use.
They smell fresh. Do you want to source you a pair of socks?
A what?
A pair of socks.
Clean socks.
Yeah, that'd be lovely. Yes, yeah? Please. What do you reckon, Hill?
Okay, thank you.
I think we're just down here, are we?
I smell fur.
We'll swab.
Yeah, OK.
Let's swab.
OK, yeah, we'll swab.
To test the shoes, they're using a bacterial measuring device and looking for a level of 500 or under. Even if a reading is over 500, the accepted level for good food hygiene, it's unlikely the average healthy person will come to any harm.
There, look.
Get the bowling shoes.
Yeah. Will you put some on?
Bring it on.
Yeah.
Oh, yay.
There you go.
Leslie, you're going to do it with our bowling shoes.
What?
Germophobic Leslie sterilises all of her footwear at home and hasn't tried on anyone else's shoes since she was 6 years old.
That'll do.
Oh, wow. Oh, my God, you look like a little school kid.
Do you feel anxious or do you feel OK?
OK.
You feel OK?
We need to get the right size ball for my hand. I'd hate to think what's in the finger holes in the bowling balls.
A recent survey said people wash their hands more thoroughly in the morning. And on a night out, 15% of men didn't wash their hands at all.
You might as well be putting your finger in somebody's bum hole.
You really want to swab this? I could not. If it came out and it was like a low reading, I would be absolutely gobsmacked.
I really do reckon it will be high.
Definitely over 500. Oh, you've got to be joking. How is that so low?
At 64, the bowling ball is near surgical levels of cleanliness.
Right, let's bowl. Have that.
Oh, yes, I got it.
Yeah, look. Got bowl, see?
She got it, she got it. Oh.
Let's push it.
Ow.
I've never seen this before, ever in my life.
Yeah.
If I can do it, somebody out there who's starting off and they think they've got the symptoms, they can do it.
This will encourage me to get involved a bit more when my kids. I don't want to deprive them of doing things just because I don't like it, because that would be selfish of me.
So I'm proud of everybody.
Yeah.
We've done it. Let's go now.
Yeah.
Later, our obsessive compulsives push their boundaries further by hitting a cocktail bar.
We're leaving.
In Bridgend, obsessive cleaner Zara has decided to ambitiously tackle four rooms in Joe's six-roomed house. Sundan's bedroom, living room, Joe's bedroom and kitchen.
I like everything in its place, very decorative, very pretty, highly polished. In my kitchen, I've got, as I said, the show oven glove, show tea towel, show olive oil, show vodka. I don't want to drink because it looks too pretty. And that's kind of what I'm trying to bring to your house.
But before Zara's standards can be set, she's tasked Joe to sift through some of the 7 years worth of clutter in the garden.
Stan's first birthday card off his nan. Oh, I am going to struggle a bit. I am going to try. Oh.
I will be cleaning what I do best. Jo will have to sort out which she doesn't do best, but she's going to learn to.
At home, Zara spends 15 hours a week on her kitchen alone and gets through 8 bottles of bleach.
I love bleach. One, because it gets everything really clean, but two, it's just got a lovely smell.
I hate that smell. I'm never going to use bleach in my house. But she's a whiz and she's using her magic now and doing the same in my house like she's done with hers.
It's just satisfying. Every little groove I'm going in, it's like a lovely feeling. I mean, I've done all the bleach in the house already and I haven't even done one room yet.
2 hours into the clean, Jo, left to her own devices, has only parted with one bag of rubbish.
Yeah.
What's the hardest things to get rid of, Jo? What's the things that are...
Mainly the boys.
Boys' things.
The boys' things, yeah. I don't know what... I mean...
Why do you think it's the boys' things that...
I don't know if it's because they've, like, grown up so fast and...
You want to hang on to, like, little bits of their childhood?
Yeah.
And... OK. I don't want you to get rid of any memories, Jo. That's not what I'm here to do.
No, but I don't want to keep everything because otherwise I'm going to be in the same boat.
With temperatures soaring into the 90s and progress slow, Zara leaves Jo in the garden while she turns her attention to Jo's youngest son, Dan's bedroom.
There's no order. They're higgledy-piggledy. They're different colours. They're different sizes. They're driving me bonkers. They've got to come off.
I'm not as organised as Zara, as you can see, but I'm trying. I am trying really hard.
I can't even describe this afternoon. It's like the nearest I think I've ever been to insanity. I'm in a 7-year-old boy's bedroom, kneeling on a bin bag on the hottest day of the year, peeling stickers off the wall. It's absolutely bizarre.
On the Isle of Wight, obsessive cleaner Glenn has set himself the task of restoring order to 3 of the 15 rooms in the former hotel.
Morning, David. Are you decent?
But 3 days into the 4-day clean, they're yet to finish the kitchen.
Yeah, yesterday when you opened the fridge, I was a bit embarrassed by your reaction.
Were you?
And a bit upset about the way you reacted.
Oh, I should think so.
At home, Glenn spends 16 hours a week cleaning his one-bedroom flat.
I'll do this.
OK.
I would like you to get cracking on anything you can see.
OK.
Please. Oh, yes.
It does seem as if I'm spending my life at a cleaning school.
Can you appreciate, though, that you need a bit of tuition, a bit of guidance by the state of this kitchen and this house?
I just couldn't be asked to do this before. I've got other things to do.
So now we're getting to the crux of it, really, aren't we? It's laziness. You've basically just said it.
I actually have a life.
Hey, what have I said to you many times? I have a life too. That does not wash with me.
Well, hours and hours does seem an awful long time to me for a person who lives in a one-bedroom flat.
Glenn won't cook in his own kitchen, but cleans it religiously. Unlike David, who, because of ill health, never cleans his.
This is quite irritating because this is stopping me from being able to crack on and clean.
Yeah, I'd rather be doing something else than this.
So what are you usually doing?
Early in the morning on a Saturday, I'd probably be in a hotel bar talking to some of my colleagues.
Which contacts are these? I'm just interested.
From the Life of Private Investigation.
Oh, OK, so you've got private investigation in your canon as well. I haven't known you very long, but so far I've heard you were a barrister.
No, I have a law degree to get into
the
civil service.
You have a law degree, you've worked in archaeology, you've worked in private investigation.
And the circus for a couple
of
years.
And the circus.
Yeah, astronomy next. Cambridge in November for astronomy and astrophysics.
Right. So how are you doing over there?
It'll all get done. Just relax.
No, I can't relax. I can't.
So is that what you're like in all of your life?
I'm super organised.
But think how many hours you could be spending doing something else.
I get plenty of time to do what I want. I mean, I'm more concerned here with the nah, don't worry about it attitude, because this is what we end up with.
Oh, don't worry about it. Glenn strikes me as someone who is very repressed and uptight and could really learn to relax a little bit more. He sort of stands robotically sometimes and he's sort of very contained. As a serious question, I've done the round and round.
Yeah.
Which is better, left to right or up and down?
In Bridgend, after 3 days, with only 2 of the 4 rooms tackled, Zara is struggling to impose her show home standards.
I woke up this morning and I thought, I'm not the same person that came to Wales. I've got a broken finger now. I haven't washed my hair for 2 days. It's only my makeup that's holding me together.
With 24 hours left, Zara's come up with a new strategy she hopes will motivate Jo into helping her more.
Today I'm going to write a bit of a list, and when we've done it, we'll cross it off and then we know, right, we're flying. Yeah?
Okay, yeah, that's brilliant.
The washing and the ironing need to get out of this room.
But before Zara can divide up the to-do list, Jo needs to run her kids to school, 5 minutes' drive away.
Sure, all right.
Luckily for Zara, husband Clive has taken the day off to help with the clean.
Come on, Clive. Now it's early morning sunbathing. Let's have a look. While Joe's away,
yeah,
make an executive decision of what you think can go and what you think can stay.
I'll have to see Joe about that. They can't just...
Oh, come on, Clive.
Oh, no,
be
I
a
can't
man.
See my mind if I see.
Just half an hour in, and there's an unexpected change to Zara's schedule.
Joanna's car's just went broken down.
Joe's car's just broken down.
Yeah.
You could not make this up. Joe has been gone 20 minutes and he's now broken down. And I'm like, give me a break.
Could put him in Ryan's room. Oh, I'll ask Sarah. Where can I do you know where I could put these?
Baby, it's your house. Right. I don't know where you can put them. It's your house. Make a decision, Clive. Right. It's your house. They're your short sweetie.
Yeah.
Find somewhere for them. I don't live in your house.
Right.
2 hours in, I'm doing it all by myself, and I will get this. I'll do my goal. So if he wants to sleep in a room with his shorts on top of his head tonight, let him get on with it.
It's been hard, like, because people tell you to do everything and don't know if I'm coming or going half the time.
Things like this, that can go. No, plastic cover, do we need it?
No.
Right. I need you, like this today, because we will never get it done. Clive needs to put his hand down his pants, find his balls and make a decision. It's going to be a long day.
The average person comes into contact with millions of germs every day. For the vast majority of healthy people, this isn't an issue. But for some sufferers of OCD, it can be a challenge. Tonight, Hayley and her team of obsessive cleaners are pushing their boundaries by visiting a busy bar.
Do you like any of these?
I can't bloody see them.
I'm not the sort of person that holds my glass up, so it's, you know, although if I got lipstick on my glass, that would totally freak me out.
I just think about the bar as well when it being sticky. I wouldn't like it if the bar was sticky.
I am anxious, but I've got a little bit of excitement as well, actually.
It'd be lovely if my mum could have, like, at least a little bit of a social life. Because, I mean, next year I'm going to be leaving, I'm going to go travelling, and my mum's going to be, like, by herself. Thank you.
I really am looking forward to pushing the OCD.
I can't remember the last time I ordered a drink.
It feels so... just really weird.
If I was going out on the weekend, I would usually have a drink or two before I went out because it makes me look a little bit more confident and less nervous about what I'm going to come into contact with.
I've haggled everything, even your fingernails.
In a study of cleanliness, rims of wine glasses were found to be dirtier than the toilet door handle in the same establishment. But dishwashers will eradicate 99.9% of all bacteria.
Come on, let's do the stem of the glass.
A reading of 500 or under is considered clean enough for food preparation.
We're leaving.
I don't mind.
Okay. That doesn't bother me.
Despite her initial shock at a reading of 494...
Check there's no lipstick marks on it, you know.
Leslie's decided to overcome her 20 years of fear about drinking in a bar.
Oh, my God. Oh, that is so nice. It just does reiterate that, like, the OCD is just a fault, so I'm really pleased.
Normally, Germaphobe Tuesday would sanitise even her bar stool with an anti-vac wipe, but because of the low swab reading, she's starting to relax.
Do you want to try a bit of mine?
Yeah, go on then. I don't usually do straws, right? I don't drink out of straws.
It's a new straw.
OK.
Tests have shown drinking from a straw is more hygienic than drinking from a glass.
Right, OK. Bloody hell.
Yeah.
Do you know, she won't even drink from the same bottle as me.
She won't even hug her mother.
She won't even hug her.
I need you to know this.
Look at my powers.
Juicy, do you want to swab a straw?
Yeah.
Or...
swab the straw.
What?
All the way around.
Oh, it's
high,
I'm off.
Oh!
What is it?
What do you think?
Is it under 500?
It's 260.
This is twice as clean as the recommended 500 for good food hygiene.
That's fine, I can over that.
I mean, next you may be hugging.
Yeah, I actually will.
She doesn't even hug you.
The
last time I had a hug off that was when it was about 4. You don't even kiss me, hug me or anything. You, like, hugged someone.
Mm-hmm.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Boundaries.
Yeah.
Pushed.
On the Isle of Wight, after 3 days, David's kitchen is finally clear. With a day to go, Glenn's concerned that David's poor health will prevent them from finishing the dining room and bar in time.
How are you doing, David?
I think I did something to exacerbate what I did the other day with my ribs.
So what happened? You lift something too heavy, you leaned over too far?
Just leaned over a bit too far, and I knew when I was going to be sick.
Minimalist Glenn is keen to start on the old bar, home to many of David's most weird and wonderful curiosities.
This could be a really fantastic room for displaying your interesting keepsakes, right?
Yeah.
But at the moment, it's just buried under mountains of boxes and stuff and who knows what.
Can we move my Fiji mermaid? Because I would not like her to get
Fiji mermaid,
damaged.
Absolutely.
Can I stick her up
I
there?
I adore the Fiji mermaid. We're going to display her properly at the end.
But David's emotional attachment isn't just to his curios.
That's an ancient Open University book.
Yeah.
That cannot possibly be relevant or useful to you now.
Might be.
I think these should all go in the skip. Nobody uses videos now.
I do. It's a flea circus.
So can that go in the skip?
No, this is part of the Magic Circle's properties.
Right, it looks a bit knackered, though.
Yeah, well, like life.
I mean, you know, he's making visits to the skip with one carrier bag and one box under his arm. We need more than that. We need armfuls of stuff. So what's that you found?
This is one of my parachutes.
One of your parachutes?
Yeah, this is...
Why am I even asking?
This dates from about 1943, I think.
Right, that's as much as I care to know. It doesn't belong in here. What is this, for example? Can you tell me what this is?
Yeah, when my father had his dental practice, this was one of the things that he had hung on the wall.
What is it?
It's a beak of a swordfish.
Do you want to keep it?
Because
it looks, it's all bits fallen off it. It looks a bit past its prime.
This is about £2,500 if you want to go and buy one.
You don't seem to look after your sentimental items like, say, the rest of us would do.
To Glenn's frustration, David is reluctant to part with anything in the bar.
I've bitten off more than I can chew here, I freely admit it. That room has just defeated me. I mean, we've been at it for hours on end. We've barely even finished the one room, never mind the one at the back.
I think that... by his very nature, he gives himself stress. Does he need stress to thrive on, maybe? I don't want to get into amateur psychology, but he does seem to like the stress and complain about it at the same time.
Those are actually quite nice, yeah.
So I don't understand how somebody can be so obsessed with cleaning and tidying. What has it made you quite like that?
Ever since I was a kid, I've always had even a neat and tidy bedroom at home. What I'm still struggling to understand, David, is where, you know, this behaviour comes from.
I think the collecting thing, like you, is inherited. All my family collected. We used to all live in big houses, so with big houses you need to fill the rooms with stuff.
Why do you need to fill them with stuff?
Otherwise it's just a very large empty room.
How are your ribs at the moment? Are you still in pain?
I didn't have a very good night last night.
Right. So I didn't have a very good last night either, you know. I came away from here very frustrated, very stressed and quite upset because I've come in and I've done so much and all I've had is just a couple of perfunctory gestures, you know, wiping a few surfaces or saying, yes, this can go in the skip. As you know, I wanted to do the back room too. It's not going to happen. I mean, you don't even seem like you care.
But I think I'm just a natural collector.
Because this isn't a collection. There's no order here. I don't know. I'm never going to understand it, and I've had it. I've given up trying to. So really, I'm just going to crack on, get the boxes out. A rubbish bag. I need to get something out of this room.
I think poor Glenn might have lost the plot a bit this morning. I think this week has been a bit too much for him. Yeah, I don't think I'm going to convert him to collecting thousands of little China kitty cats.
It's the last day of the clean and Joe and Clive are finally working together to help Zara, who's set to bring out her impeccable standards to four rooms.
I've brought a bit of show to the front room at least so far.
However, after 35 hours of decluttering, Zara has only brought her show home status to three of the rooms.
I'm a bit disappointed that I haven't been able to do the whole house. I feel like I've failed myself because I haven't done what I set out to do, but...
You've done so much, because there was a lot stuff you.
Right, come on in, boys.
With the kids home from school, it's time to show them what Zara and their parents have achieved.
Whoa.
Their younger son Dan's bedroom used to be filled to the ceiling with unused toys and clothes. It's now airy and organised, leaving a fun space to play in.
What do you think of your bed? Does that look cool?
Yeah.
Put all your monkeys on the bed, because I know you like them. And everything's got a place. Where's your dressing up stuff?
Yeah.
That's it. Good boy.
The living room was overrun with 7 years' worth of clutter, preventing them from spending quality time together. Now it's a room the Reddy family can relax in.
What do you think, boys?
Whoa, this is really good.
Oh, stunning, isn't it? Mm. Oh, look at that. It's better than what I even expected to be. So it's just, it don't look like our house.
It's really nice now. My friends will be able to sleep over and we can have a laugh and it'll be good.
Want it to go back to where it was?
No.
Definitely not.
Do you think
not.
It looks better now?
Yeah.
Quick, catch Zara because she's going and we want to give her presents.
Thank you for tidying my room.
Oh, you're welcome, Ryan.
Oh, thank you. I wanted her to be boss and I wanted her to make sure she kicked our butts. So, fantastic. Yeah, feeling good.
Thank you.
Bye. I don't think I clean too much. I'm happy that my house looks like a show home.
Hey, keep it tidy, no stickers, Dan.
I'm not going to change. I love my life the way it is.
On the Isle of Wight, Glenn has spent the last 4 days attempting to strip back David's 28-year historic hoard. In the 15-room ex-hotel, he wanted to reclaim David's kitchen and empty the bar and back dining room to display key pieces.
The back room of the bar, I'm not going to get there. It's absolutely impossible. Clearly, David doesn't care. So, I'll try and finish off the main room, the dingy room with the actual bar in it.
To satisfy his desire to make order from David's chaos, Glenn calls in a local chippy to build bookshelves in the bar.
I'm not going to be able to arrange the books the way I would like to have done. It's not going to resemble a library, it's going to look like a charity shop, but at least it'll be a relatively tidy charity shop.
David's reluctance to part with much of his hoard means Glenn has shunted boxes into the back dining room. 2 tons of rubbish has been skipped, 6 large boxes and 6 bin bags have gone to charity, and David's been tasked with polishing selected items. Meanwhile, Glenn brings his precision and symmetry to the newly cleaned kitchen. Glenn finally buffs the bar, showcasing David's more interesting artifacts.
Not an exact science, but it keeps me happy when I see that bubble in the middle, which it is.
David's friend Mary has come to see what Glenn has helped him achieve over the last few days.
I suppose you want to see what I've been up to?
I absolutely would love to see what you've been up to.
Before, David's kitchen surfaces were submerged under condiments and crockery, and his fridge was foul.
Wow, look at it.
Looks totally different, doesn't it?
Absolutely. I can't believe it's the same place. It's amazing, absolutely amazing. It's a totally different place.
And it's all thanks to Glenn, so thank you, Glenn.
Thanks, Glenn.
Well, yeah, you're welcome. I mean, I'm really proud of what, you know, I've managed to do in here. And, of course, you'll remember the fridge.
The infamous fridge.
Clock that.
Yeah, the smell is definitely not here anymore.
So it's going to stay as an ornamental piece, isn't
it? Yeah.
And of course, didn't want to leave David without a fridge at all, so we've got a brand new one. He's got his ornamental and he's got his functional.
If I needed to make a meal, I'd be happy to make a meal in here.
David's old hotel bar used to be buried under his historic hoard. Now Glenn has cleaned and cleared space to make a feature of both David's mahogany bar and items from his collection.
So come on in.
Wow. It's got character. This is a room now. This is a comfortable room.
Well, there's a nautically themed cabinet behind
you. I can see. There's the mermaid. It looks really good. This is a real livable space, isn't it?
Yeah, it is now.
Beautiful.
Thank you, Glenn.
Wonderful.
Well, speechless. Thank you, Glenn.
My pleasure, I suppose. I've learnt about myself that I've got grit, because it takes balls of steel, I think, to tackle something like that, so I'm really, really proud of myself. I feel like now, after that, after David's floor and David's fridge, I can do anything.
Have a nice trip home.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed.
I think the outcome of spending time with Glenn has been that I will seriously consider emptying a few more of the rooms in the house.
Don't let him slack off now.
I'm certainly passing
the responsibility over to you. This is your job.
I think if Glenn and I spent a lot more time together, and by that I mean a lot more time together, in about 6 months, 12 months, he might have loosened up a little bit.